Mr. Shah, the President of Ficci, Mr. Somani, the President-elect, the Secretary General, ladies and gentlemen, it is always a privilege to be a participant in the annual Ficci meet. I have been coming here for a few years, whether I was in opposition or in government. But today was indeed very tough. Because this was the only window available to me post-lunch. And I can understand post-lunch how difficult it is for all of you to suffer a heavyweight lecture. So with that handicap, I will have to begin. But it's all a part of the game. I had about 4 meetings of my various PSUs, annual general meeting, 2-3 marriages, 4 o'clock Supreme Court function, 2 functions in the evening and 3 marriages in the night. So this was the only window available. So kindly bear with me. Now, when we talk of building a new India, first I need to compliment Mr. Shah, Mr. Somani and all of you for having the most apt and appropriate topic in the present world. I hope that's not building a new India. Yes. I think building a new India is a tectonic shift in the approach as we think about India. It is an inspiration to think big. And I always say, unless you start thinking big, you cannot achieve modest success. Because the modest success invites you to do better. Let me give a very interesting example how thinking big gives the result. Apart from law and justice and IT, I'm also the Minister of Electronic Manufacturing. In 2014, when I was taking a briefing from all the segments of my department, then the whole emerging world of electronic manufacturing was conveyed to me. And there was just a director and a joint secretary. हमने कहा तुम दो लोग क्या कर लोगे ये दुनिया तो बहुत बड़ी है एंड देन वी स्टार्टेड थिंकिंग बिग विथ नॉट दैट होप ऑफ सक्सेस व्हेन आई टॉक ऑफ डिजिटल प्रोफाइल ऑफ इंडिया लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन आई विल इलैबोरेट इट फर्दर बट आई होप यू मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड इंडियाज डिजिटल प्रोफाइल ए पॉपुलेशन 130 करोड़ Mobile phone 121 crores, a smartphone 50 crores, Aadhaar 122 crores. We have added mobile phone in the last 4.5 years equal to the population of Italy and France. That is the scale and speed on which we work. One day the Prime Minister asked me, Ravi, tum itni mobile ki charcha karte ho, banta kitna hai desh mein? And there were only 2 mobile factories when we had come to power. Ladies and gentlemen, today I am happy to tell you, India is manufacturing through 127 mobile manufacturing factories in India, one of the highest rate of growth. And if you include all the component factory, there are 268 factories. And some of my friends who are from Delhi or Noida, I wish to inform you that Noida and Greater Noida is emerging as a big center of electronic manufacturing. There are 57 mobile and component manufacturing factories only and only in Noida, apart from various parts of the country. From 18,000 crores, the revenue has reached to 1,32,000 crores. And the latest Samsung factory is going to manufacture 1 crore mobile phone per month. Now India is emerging as a big center, second to China. I went to South Korea, I went to Germany, I tried to tap the market, understand. Today, 5 lakh plus people are getting employment in these scenarios. This is just a doable part of it. Our Prime Minister has talked of Swachh Bharat. I want to give you just one statistics. Since 15th August 1947 till 26th of May 2014 when we came to power, the total number of toilets constructed in rural India was 6 crore 25 lakhs. From 15th August 1947 till 26th May 2014. In the last 4.5 years under our government, we have constructed 9 crore 25 lakh toilet in the rural parts of India. Log wahi hai na, system bhi wahi hai, officers bhi wahi hai. How this could be done? The third, I would like to give you one statistics. Is the optical fiber network. I had the privilege to handle the telecom ministry for 2.5 years. There was a national optical fiber network designed to connect 2,50,000 gram panchayats of India by optical fiber. This program was launched in 2011. It was known as NOFAN, National Optical Fiber Network. Now it is known as BharatNet. Since 2011 till 26th of May 2014, in 3 years, only 358 kilometers of optical fiber was laid. 358 kilometers. In 4.5 years, we have laid 2,49,000 kilometers and 1 lakh gram panchayats have been connected. What I'm trying to highlight is, without trying to claim undue credit, the same country, the same people, the same processes. If you are able to erect the larger picture, people respond. I've heard from news report on, well, the finance minister talked about the fragile five when we had come to power. And how, what was the case of Indian economy? What was the state of the banks? What has happened? Today, we have surpassed Japan, France, as the sixth biggest economy of the world. In terms of ease of doing business, we have scaled 65 points in 4 years. In case of FDI, in case of growth rate, the World Bank or the IMF, all are saying India is the fastest growing economy in the world. This could be achieved. You know, there is a very fundamental philosophy which my party and my government have followed. And this is very important to be conveyed. It is always possible to have growth without equity. It will be pro-rich. It will be elitist. But in order to have real equity, you must have growth. Agar roti 10 hogi, to baatne mein katnai hogi. Agar roti 10 lakh hogi, to aram se roti batengi. Aur is mulk ki samasya ye hai, ki roti baatne ke siyasat bahut hui hai, roti ki sankhya kaise badhai jaye, ye siyasat nahi hui hai. And what our government has done, built upon the legacy of Shatal Bihari Bajpai, that if you enlarge the size of economy, create transparent, fair conditions for the businessmen like you to operate, then you operate, you do business, you expand your business, you pay taxes, and from that taxes, the government works for the poor, underprivileged, and also creating infrastructure. Not rinam litva ghriyam privet. Loan liye jao, aur baki chhod do. I would just give you, you have seen that number many times, but I would like to give just, I know many of you may be knowing, The number of intent taxpayers who filed income tax return in 13-14 was 3.82 crores, 3.82 crores. And the number of Indians who are filing income tax return in 17-18 is 6.86 crores, 6.86 crores, more than double. As regards income tax collections, 13-14, the total income tax collected was 6.38 lakh crores. In 17-18, 10.2 lakh crores. How is it the same system, the same tax officers, the same people, when you outline a broader narrative? But ladies and gentlemen, what is important in the pursuit of a new India is some of the larger narratives of program based upon technology which our government has initiated, which Mr. Shah just mentioned about. And there is a fundamental philosophy behind it. You all are creators of New India in business, members of Ficci. I would like to share with that vision of my Prime Minister. When in 2014 the Prime Minister was contesting the election to become the Prime Minister, he gave a vision. If I am elected to power, I would like to create an India where IT plus IT is equal to IT. IT, India's talent, plus IT, information technology, is equal to IT, India tomorrow. That's the India I want to create. And I never knew that he will give on my small shoulders this heavy responsibility to run this extraordinary objective. There is a second philosophical underpinning behind this application of technology, and I want all of you to know about it. India missed the Industrial Revolution for a variety of historical reasons, namely, we were under the imperial power, not independent. India missed the entrepreneurial revolution which happened in the 60s, 70s, 80s and 90s because of the scourge of license, permit, quota, Raj. We don't want to miss the digital revolution. We want to become leaders in the digital revolution. Digital delivery of services, digital governance, digital empowerment. And from there came technology-based programs like Digital India, Make in India, Startup India, Stand Up India, Smart Cities. All are basically designed to transform India. This I would like you to understand. Indian IT professionals have done very well. And if some of them are sitting here, I wish to compliment them. Less support from the government, more on their own. Today, India's IT industry is worth $168 billion. In revenue and $125 billion in exports. Indian IT professionals hoisted the tricolor in 200 cities of 80 countries. They have given jobs to about 40 lakh people directly and 1 crore 25 lakh people indirectly. And mind you, one third are women. We are very proud of that. But Digital India is beyond that. Digital India is transformative. To empower ordinary Indians with the power of technology, and most important, usher in digital revolution, digital inclusion, bridging the digital divide between digital haves and digital have-nots. And most important, this objective of Digital India and digital inclusion is to be achieved based upon technology, which is low-cost, developmental, and inclusive. You need to understand that. What do you mean by low-cost technology? I will give you one example. I just told you Aadhaar number, mobile number. We open 32 crore, 320 million bank account of the poor. Link that with Aadhaar. And it started linking to the mobile, sending all the welfare measures from gas to Manrega payment, to other scholarship, etc., directly to the bank account. And do you know how much we have saved? 90,000 crores, which used to be pocketed by middlemen and fictitious persons. Digital governance is good governance. I would like to share a little about Aadhaar. What is Aadhaar? Aadhaar is a digital identity to supplement the physical identity. I thought I would share. You have never examined your Aadhaar card with what I am saying. This is my Aadhaar card. Can you look at it? What does it contain? My photograph, I am a male, and my permanent Patna address. What it does not contain? My religion, my community, my caste, my income, my medical record, or my sexual preferences by which I can be profiled. But the system contains fingerprints and the iris of 122 crore Indians. How does it operate? A customer goes to a bank and the bank asks his Aadhaar number. And immediately he talks to the system in Bangalore and Manesar. And the system in half of a second confirms this number belongs to Ravi Shankar Prasad. We do authentication of 3 crore cards every 3 seconds. And the system does not know what for the query has been made. The system only knows, confirm, this number belongs to whom. And the system matches that number with the fingerprint and the iris. How much one Aadhaar costs? Roughly $1, low cost. How it is kept? In a safe and secure condition backed by a parliamentary law with due regard to privacy. I, as the IT and law minister of India, if I disclose my iris and fingerprint to an unauthorized person, I can be hauled up and subjected to prosecution. Today the world is amazed by this kind of innovation happening in India. This is called low-cost technology. We have come with an interesting program, e-hospital. Today, about 400 hospitals are available, which are on e-hospital platform. People sitting in Patna or Lucknow or Guwahati can book their reservations with AIMS through their mobile phone. You'll be given a date, you need not come there. Soil health card, 15 crore farmers are having a digital card. E-scholarship, about 1.5 crore students are being paid, nearly 5,000 crore of e-scholarship at a click of a button, all safe and secure. E-NAM, about 1 crore farmers are using more than 500 mandis digitally linked. I would tell you something very interesting. We have formed a platform E-GEM. What is E-GEM? Government has to purchase from balti to bucket to kursi to table to whatnot, to glasses. We have to go for e-tender. Now everyone can apply on E-GEM. An open competition. The government of India has saved coolly 37 crore of rupees in purchasing dustbin for government of India offices, because all the hassles of tender, etc., was completely out of question on the digital platform. E-visa. Today, 161 countries are on e-visa, and the tourist inflow of India rose enormously. I'm only giving you certain examples. We are making about 6 crore Indians digitally literate. 1.5 crore have been certified in the rural parts of India. Ayushman Bharat, we are going to give 5 lakh per year, poor people 50 crore. Again, digital connect. This whole GST rising on digital platform. Today, ladies and gentlemen, apart from the conventional IT performance, today digital delivery of services and digital empowerment have become the cornerstone of India's digital profile. Let me give you one interesting story, digital payment. And I would like all of you to know how India is rising in a phenomenal manner as far as digital payment is concerned. You must have heard the names of the Bheem app. I would just like to tell you one number, and since Bheem app and Aadhaar come under me, in September 2017, the transaction was worth 5,325 crores. And after 1 year, 2 months, Bheem app UPI transactions has shown a transaction of 66,500 crores. And mind you, there is a limitation of transaction, and majority of them from the semi-urban and rural area. The way e-commerce is rising in India. Electronic manufacturing, I just talked about, from defense electronics to medical electronics to automobile electronics to LED bulbs, all are rising in India, and we need to work more. These are the clear signs of the aspirational India. One thing I would like to share with you, I see a lot of young men sitting here, is startup movement is picking up very fast. Do you know, ladies and gentlemen, India is the third biggest startup system in the world today, 5,000 plus. And many of the startups have become unicorn. Unicorns mean turnover $1 billion plus. And many of them are servicing clients even in America and England. I had thought that unless I make Digital India a mass movement, it will not succeed. And I came with two programs, and whose success I would like to share with you here. I remember after becoming minister in 2014, I had gone to meet the top IT giants in Bangalore, and I had 2 hours meeting with them. And when I came out, large number of boys and girls from Bihar, UP, Assam, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh were there. So because of television, wo chehra pehchante hain. So I went to say hello to them. Sir, will you do something for us? Bangalore is very costly. No offense to friends from Bangalore, but that's what they said. This particular point struck me like anything. And then I came with the idea of BPO in the small towns of India. Tier 3, Tier 4 cities. There's a lot of opposition from my officers. Ki, sir, ye kyon kar rahe hain aap? I am giving 1 lakh subsidy per seat. Do you know, ladies and gentlemen, I launched in 2015. Now it is 3.5 years, nearly. 124 BPOs have started operating in 26 states and Union Territory of India. And where are they? In Kohima, in Nagaland. They are also in the capital of Manipur, Imphal. They are in Dibrugarh. They are in Guwahati. They are in Bhubaneswar. They are in Cuttack. 4 are coming in Bengal, from Nadiad to Murshidabad. In my city of Patna, there are 9 BPOs operating in Samastipur. They have come in Kanpur, to Bareilly, to Ghaziabad. The latest one is going to start in Ghazipur, Aurangabad, to Bhiwandi. Now, can you think this India was waiting for a digital push? And whenever I visit some of these, the most pleasing impression, image comes to me is, 2/3 are women who are operating their computers and working systems. And many of them are getting orders from America, England, Australia. The second is common service centers. Digital kiosk giving 300 digital delivery of services. Their number was 80,000. I have scaled it to 3 lakhs now. 12 lakh bachche bachchiyan kaam karte hain usme. Many are entrepreneurs. From digital payment to railway ticketing to passport to insurance to giving land records to digital literacy program, what not, a skilling program. This only confirms Indians first observe technology, then they adopt it, then they start enjoying it, and they become empowered in the process. I've always said, and I would repeat, Mr. Shah here, let Ficci do some objective study as to the transformation happening in ordinary Indians with the application of technology. And one particular image I will never forget. My security stopped me from taking that photograph. I sit as an IT minister in the scope complex, and as a law minister, I sit in Shastri Bhavan. So from scope, I was coming to Shastri Bhavan. There is a big light. So my car has stopped. I saw a rickshaw thelawala having two smartphones. Okay? And one say he was talking, ki sahab, maine aapka maal pahuncha diya. And the second he said, abhi aadha ghanta aur lagega, aapka bhi pahuncha dunga. I thought no one told him, but he realized if I have to be in business, he must have two smartphones. That is the India which Digital India designs to empower. And that is happening. I think that study is required to be done in a more extensive way as to how this transformation is happening. And ladies and gentlemen, I wish to make it very clear to you that Digital India is politics neutral. Digital India is center state neutral. Digital India is ideology neutral. Digital India is only India positive. And therefore, I'm very happy to say that all the state governments today are adopting it. Some are adopting it willingly. Some are adopting it. I should not be left out. And I think that is a great moment for the empowerment of ordinary Indian. Therefore, I would appeal to all of you in your own way. It is in your interest to apply technology. Yes, I understand the challenges. Cyber security is one of them. And my Prime Minister always said, cyber war is like a bloodless war. And therefore, we are pushing the case for greater application of technology. Auditors, security auditors, training to judges, policemen, business people, as to how to keep their system cyber attack free. I'm just also pushing a case. The report has been completed. And that is the case of India as a $1 trillion digital economy. And ladies and gentlemen, let me make a declaration here today. I have not the slightest doubt that India's digital economy is going to become a $1 trillion economy in the coming 3 to 5 years with 50 to 75 lakh employment potential. And whenever I talk of digital economy, I mean telecommunication and IT in the conventional sense. Then I mean e-commerce, I mean digital payment, I mean new technology from artificial intelligence to robotics to machine learning. Then obviously I mean cyber security, small products. And most important, digital payment. All startup movement. Therefore, it is also I have been an activist for my student life. Some of my friends will be knowing me, worked on Lok Nayak Jai Prakash Narayan. But the India I am watching as an IT minister is mind-boggling. And today, in this Ficci convention, let me declare the kind of new avenue, new confidence, and new courage IT is giving to young Indians. No power on earth can stop India becoming a truly global power. That's what I would like to tell you. I never talk about myself, but just now I would like to share with two instances. There is the apolitical famous NGO of London, of World Bank people, retired civil servants, academics. They measure governance of various countries on various measuring rods and standards. This time they had picked up e-governance. And they have made India, declared India, as a top 20 global leaders in e-governance. All has happened in 4 years. Hardly a week ago, the UN Secretary General wrote a letter to me whereby they have constituted a committee, high-powered committee of 10 eminent people to supplement the digital infrastructure for sustainable goals of the world, UN. They have also kept me as a part of the member. Why all this is happening? Because India's clout as an emerging digital power is now being globally recognized. That I would like to share with you. few words about law and justice, and then I'll conclude. I am bringing, along with the Supreme Court and the High Courts, a big tapestry of profile as far as e-courts are concerned. I want to share with you, there are close to about 19,000 courts spread in 600 court complexes which have become digitized. Today, sitting in this chamber, if you want me to know, my people and the system can say as to which, in which court of Tripura Agartala, which case is listed and which case hearing is going on. This is how we have been able to digitize process server, process summoning. All this has been able to do. We have set up a national judicial data grid, which contains the details of 10 crore cases pending and decided. How I use it? I pick it up and start writing to the Chief Justice of the High Courts that 10 saal se itne purane case aapke in jilon mein pending hai. Please expedite that. It is not fair. Many times they have contested that the number is not correct, Mr. Law Minister. Humne kaha your assistant can may or may not give you the correct picture, but my digital platform would never give me the wrong picture. And ultimately, they were right. They agreed that they were wrong. So for the application of digital technology, we are seeking to fast track. We are also making a big push to India become a center of arbitration, national and global, particularly institutional arbitration. The bill has been passed by the Lok Sabha, pending in the Raj Sabha. Whenever I say of institutional arbitration, I mean there must be a body to properly identify good institutional arbitration centers. There must be an audit of arbitrators, how they are functioning, how fast they deliver their cases. And this Arbitration Council of India, designed to audit, will be headed by retired Chief Justice of India. And plus, Delhi is going to become a big center, ICDR, as an arbitration center. I'm very happy to know that because of the Ficci involvement, CII's involvement and others, large number of institutional arbitration is going on. Recently, we have changed a law, Commercial Court Act, whereby even 3 lakh disputes can be decided on a fast-track basis in commercial courts. You know, ladies and gentlemen, I can never say the size of India with so much of litigation, everything can change overnight. But what is important is, with the application of technology, we are seeking to fast-track things. I'll just give you one example. One day, Prime Minister said, ki, Ravi, tum jara dekho, kitne kitne purane kanun desh mein hai. And some of the friends who are from Bengal, I would like to share with them, the Sarai Act of 1860. To humne pucha, ye kya hai? Kaha ki, angrezon ke samay mein aapko kahin sarai mein rukna tha, to uske liye permission lena padta tha. To humne, angrez to chale gaye, kanun kyun bada hua abhi tak? Then we started going deeper into the matter. And we have already deleted, scrapped 1,500 old laws. They have already been scrapped, and about 500 are still in the pipeline, pending in the parliament. Therefore, from commercial court disposal, to arbitration, to scrapping old laws, appointment, you know it, we have been one of the highest number of appointment. But you know, in appointment, I have to work with the judiciary, we have come with the NJAC, but judiciary didn't accept that. That is a separate question. Whenever Mr. Shah or Somani will call me for a legal issue, then I will elaborately talk about that. But we worked together, and some of the highest number of judges in the last 3 years in the High Court and Supreme Court have been appointed. There were 5,000 vacancies in the subordinate judiciary. Again, we insisted, and the Chief Justice of India has taken on a priority basis to fill up those vacancies. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, from filling up the vacancy to scrapping of the laws to fast-tracking commercial litigation, these are some of the issues we have been addressing, including legal access to the poor people to the application of technology, in which I am working both as an IT minister and law minister. What is my concluding take, ladies and gentlemen? My concluding take is trust in India. Have confidence in Indians. Trust in India, have confidence in Indians. You just create, you give them the idea, and change occurs. One day Prime Minister says, ki 18,000 gaon mein bijli kyon nahi hai? What is this? And within 6 months, even in Arunachal Hills, the ultimately energy reached. I had the privilege to be a minister in Bajpayee government also. When this whole national highway scheme came about, you know, linking Kashmir to Kanyakumari, from Agartala to Surat, 4-lane, 6-lane highway, there was big opposition. Kahan se jameen aayegi? Itni mitti kahan se aayegi? Kisan virodh karenge. Atal ji was a powerful speaker, our great leader, now is no more. But in the meetings, he used to speak very less. It was a 2-hour meeting, he just kept on hearing. And all of us are looking at him. He said, karna hai, aur kuch nahi. Ladies and gentlemen, last year I had gone to Kanyakumari. And there was a function. And I was told, just adjacent to where I was speaking, the Kashmir to Kanyakumari 4-lane, 6-lane highway terminates. I asked my private secretary, how much time I have to reach to the airport. He said, 1 hour aapke paas hai. I will not be able to drive all the way from Kashmir to Kanyakumari in this life. No time. At least allow me to drive for an hour. And let me have an emotional feel that if you have an idea, if you have the commitment, if you have the hard work, results are possible. That's the new India we're looking forward to. And ladies and gentlemen, political ups and downs will keep on coming. But what is important is this new growth story of India with the hard work of people, political, bureaucrat, business people, ordinary people must continue. And that is our vision and that is our mission. We'll surely do it. Thank you. Namaskar. Jai Hind.